everyone. Welcome to this event. I'm Susan Koshy, and I'm the director of the Unit for Criticism and Interpretive Theory. And I'd like to thank all of you for making the time to join us for this event, which includes a talk by Jay Rosen and a discussion with Niala Boodhoo. I want to thank Jay particularly because he so generously agreed to be here with us on relatively short notice and has accommodated numerous requests that we received for interviews, meetings, and exchanges. He's also been extraordinarily flexible with the format of this event, which actually kept evolving from the time we first set up the possibility of this visit. I'm also extremely grateful to Niala Boodhoo and the entire team of the 21st for enthusiastically getting on board with plans for this event and for getting everything done in lightning speed. Finally, thanks to the units which are co-sponsoring this event, the Center for Advanced Study, the Klein Center for Democracy, and the Institute of Communications Research. Since we've changed the format of this event quite a bit, I just want to run through how we're going to do this. So we'll begin with Jay Rosen's lecture, which should run for about 40 minutes. And then Jay will be joined by Niala for a discussion which should run about 15 minutes. And from there, we're going to switch to a Q&A with the audience. I'll now turn it over to my colleague, Scott Althaus, who's professor of political science and communications and director of the Klein Center for Democracy, and he's going to introduce Jay Rosen. Thank you.
So as you just heard, I'm faculty in both political science and communication. My area is political communication, and I have known Jay Rosen's name for over 20 years, but I only had the pleasure of meeting him a few minutes ago, and it is a privilege to introduce him on this occasion. Jay Rosen is Associate Professor of Journalism at New York University, where he joined the faculty in 1986 after earning his PhD in Media Studies at NYU under the supervision of Neil Postman, a name that many of you are probably familiar with. He directed the Knight Foundation's Project on Public Life and the Press from 1993 to 1997 and served as chair of NYU's Journalism Department from 1999 to 2005. He currently serves as director of that department's Studio 20 program in digital journalism and as a member of the Wikipedia Advisory Board. Professor Rosen is author of two books, What Are Journalists For?, published in, which is a good question to be asking, published in 1999 by Yale University Press, and also Getting the Connections Right, Public Journalism and the Troubles in the Press, published in 1996 by the 20th Century Fund. He's also published in The Nation, Columbia Journalism Review, The Chronicle of Higher Education, The New York Times, The Washington Post, The Los Angeles Times, Newsday, and many others. Online, he has written for Huffington Post, Salon.com, Tanpain.com, and Pointer.org. Early in his academic career, Professor Rosen became the leading scholarly voice in partnership of sorts with Buzz Merritt of the Wichita Eagle, who was the leading journalistic voice, for advancing an alternative version of what newsmaking in the United States could look like that came to be known as civic journalism or public journalism. In this model of newsmaking, journalists become facilitators of public debate about common problems rather than merely spectators. And drawing its lineage all the way back to a 1920s conversation between John Dewey and Walter Lippmann, this version of public or civic journalism embraces John Dewey's vision of journalists as a member of a community with a distinctive role in stimulating conversation about matters of common concern. I'm going to quote here Professor Rosen's own definition of this because it's important for setting up what he's going to say today. Back in 1999, he says, public journalism calls on journalists to, one, address people as citizens, potential collaborators in public affairs, rather than as victims or spectators. Two, help the political community act upon, rather than just learn about, its problems. Three, improve the climate of public discussion, rather than simply watch it deteriorate. And four, help make public life go well,
so that it earns its claims on our attention. If journalists can find a way to do these things, he writes, they may in time restore public confidence in the press, reconnect with an audience that has been drifting away, rekindle the idealism that brought many of them into the craft, and contribute in a more substantial fashion to the health of American democracy. Over the past 30 years, Rosen has not only advanced and refined this idea of public journalism, but has also actively fostered its practice through his ongoing role as public intellectual and media critic. And he has done so in what, for academic scholars, is a rather unconventional venue. Over the past 15 years, his most significant academic writing has been published through his influential blog, PressThink.org. It has been running since 2003, and since that time has amassed over 6.2 million page views. It's very widely read. And for those who think that blogging is somehow a lesser form of academic publishing, I would point out that Rosen's 2006 essay entitled On Press Think, The People Formerly Known as the Audience, has nearly 600 citations in Google Scholar. That is a degree of scholarly impact that goes far beyond the usual peer-reviewed article. Professor Rosen's remarks today continue to advance the spirit of public journalism in a season when we need its vision of engaged newsmaking more than ever. Please join me in welcoming Professor Jay Rosen.
That's really cool about the 600 sites. I didn't know that. I'd never looked at that. Well, thank you very much, Susan, for inviting me here, and Scott for that very lovely introduction. And thanks to the unit for organizing this. I love that name. It sounds vaguely sinister, like the Matrix or something. The unit. That's something that could inspire paranoia, don't you think? And I'm really happy to be here because I've never been to Urbana. I've never been to this campus. But a lot of people who are very important to me and to my work have been. In many ways, the University of Illinois is the birthplace of media studies or mass communication research in the institute that still exists here. Very important campus for the origin of communication and media, mass communication as a discipline. And then for many years, the person who probably influenced me the most, except for Neil Postman, who was my mentor and dissertation chair at NYU, but the person, second most influential person in my career, was James W. Carey, who was for many years the dean of the School of Communication and Media here, and a towering figure in media studies, cultural studies, and journalism studies. So that's another reason that Illinois has always had a fascination for me. And I love these big state universities with the big sports teams and stuff, because NYU is the largest private university in the country, and we're Division III in sports. So that's like an exotic thing for me. Before I start my talk, a little bit about what I do. I kind of sit in between the practice of journalism and academic study of media. And I try to write about the press and understand the American press. I worry about it as an institution. I worry about its sustainability and its survival, its place in the culture. And I try to understand what's going on with it. But rather than address myself to other scholars, I try to work in public forums and write in a public language and engage with journalists themselves, argue with them, criticize them. They often get mad at me, which is fine. And I also talk a lot about what's going on with American journalists on social media, on Twitter, and I engage with journalists there as well, and I do that partly to develop my own ideas. So some of what I'm going to say tonight you will have heard if you follow me on social media. And these days I'm almost full time on the Trump and the press beat, because, man, there's a lot going on, you know, in that beat. So this talk is on the record. It's tweetable, and some of the ideas will be familiar to you if you follow me. And I'm going to talk for maybe 30 minutes, because having done talks on this subject throughout the winter and spring, various venues, I know from experience that this is a subject that people are very passionate about right now. And they have a lot of opinions about the media and Trump and what's going on in the interplay between the two. And so if everything works out, we should have at least an hour to talk to you about that. Okay, so let's get going. My title is Winter is Coming, to start off with something really embarrassing. I didn't know when I used this title that this is a thing from Game of Thrones. I don't watch Game of Thrones. I've never seen even a minute of that show. I thought I was borrowing the title of Garry Kasparov's book about Russia, which is called Winter is Coming. And then people started saying to me on Twitter, love the Game of Thrones reference. You know? And I'd say, yeah, man. Actually, I had no idea what they were talking about. And then people started denouncing me for using a cliche from Game of Thrones, you know? And I didn't like that either, because I didn't know it was a cliche. But what I mean by winter is coming is that is a dark time for American journalism. And what I'm going to do in my presentation is explain all the reasons why I think that. Okay, and then we can talk about them. So this is a quote from a letter that was written a couple days ago from Mexican writers and journalists to the American press. An extraordinary letter. You really have to read it. And I shared it on my Twitter feed, and something happened that has never happened to me since 2008 when I joined Twitter, which is that dozens, maybe 100 or more people said, when I read this, it made me cry. And what the letter is, it's only a few paragraphs, is it says to American journalists, for so long, you supported us when journalists in this country, in Mexico, were being terrorized and killed and driven underground by the gangs and the drug war. And often, the letter says, we could only find out what was going on in our country by reading your press. And that was an amazing gift you gave us when we couldn't actually tell the citizens of our own country what was going on. And then this is how it ends. You have stood with us during the darkest hours of press freedom in Mexico. And although we never could believe this day would come, we now stand with you. So that's what I mean by winter is coming. That's what they're saying. It's a dark time for you, and we stand by you. So let's look at some of the reasons why. I have about 20 of them. So the first one is, there's an economic crisis right now in the American press. The business model has been falling apart for a long time. A lot of reasons for that. We can talk about them later if you want. But it's led to thinned out newsrooms and a poor quality product in many cases, especially at the local level. And the reason this is important is that it's in local news that people begin to develop the habit of reading the news. And it's in local news that people originally learn why it's good to have good journalists around. And when local news declines, when you can't rely on it anymore, when the newspaper you open up is too thin to even be worth your time, you don't have that attachment anymore to journalists, to journalism, and that has consequences further up the chain. So the erosion of service at the local level due to the collapse of business models and corporate news and chain ownership and lots of other things, is weakening the press from its roots. Journalists are operating in a low trust environment for all institutions and all leaders. So Americans don't trust their institutions as much as they once did. The only real exception to that is the military. Almost every other major institution has been declining in trust for a long time. And the reason this is important is that these are the people that are newsmakers. They are the people who appear in the news. So if there is mistrust and disgust with institutions, those are the players that you find in the news, and that tends to make the news mistrusted because the people in it are mistrusted. This is quite apart from whether people trust the media. They don't trust the people who are featured in the media. You see the difference? Trust in the media itself is at historically low levels, historically in the sense of the history of polling data. We don't have polling data for the 19th century or for the 18th century, so I don't really know. But for as long as we've been doing these kinds of polls, trust in the news media itself is at an extremely low level, especially among Republicans, but not only among Republicans. For example, there's a lot of really angry Bernie Sanders fans out there who don't trust the media. Not fans, I shouldn't have said fans. Bernie Sanders supporters, citizens, voters, who don't trust the media for some very good reasons. Pew Research Center earlier last year said only about 2 in 10 Americans, 22%, trust the information they get from local news organizations. And 18% say they trust the news they get from national organizations. Gallup in September of 2016 reported that Republicans who said they have trust in the media has plummeted to 14% from 32% a year ago. So 32% in 2015, 14% in 2016. That's a rapid decline. On the political right, I didn't edit this slide well, did I? See, if my students were here, they would be laughing at me for blowing that. There's an organized campaign to discredit the press, and it is working. This is a very important fact to understand. There is an organized campaign to discredit the mainstream press in this country. And it has 3 levels to it. Obviously, now it is being led from the top. The president himself, the most powerful person in the country, conducts daily seminars in why you should hate the media and describes it in the most lurid terms. The enemy of the people is the most recent one, but he's been doing this for a while. So it's coming from the top. It also comes from the bottom in an army of online trolls and activists who shout down news stories they don't like, attack journalists who cross them in one way or another, and encourage other people in a sort of frenzy of mistrust. So there's thousands of people like this online. I hear from them all the time. And then in the middle, between the two, between the top and the bottom, there are mediating institutions like Talk Radio and Matt Drudge and Daily Caller and Breitbart that connect the top and the bottom. So when I say an organized campaign to discredit the mainstream media, that's what I mean. That's a major phenomena, and it's working. It's working in the way that I just suggested. 14% of Republicans trust the news media, down from 32% the next year. That's the result of something. It doesn't happen by accident. This is my own estimation. But about 25% to 33% of the electorate is effectively lost to mainstream journalism in the sense that they watch Fox. I don't mean that they tune in Fox. I mean they only watch Fox. My mother-in-law is one of these people. They only watch Fox. They rely on alternative news sources online that actually don't have any journalists working for them. And they reject what they see from the established press. So about between 25% and 3% of the country, of the public, is sort of not even there on the receiving end of the press. You see what I mean? So you're starting off with a quarter to a third of the country missing from the transaction. And that's a big deal. The seventh of my 20 points. For professionals in the American press, the events of the 2016 election were a devastating blow. But no season of reflection or serious reform has followed from those events. What I mean by a devastating blow is not just that they predicted the wrong result. That was devastating. Because after all, the way that political journalism, election journalism is done in this country, a lot of it is about who's going to win, right? A lot of it is about polls. Who's ahead? Who's likely to be the victor? And if you invest in horse race journalism and you call it for the wrong horse, that's a problem. And Steve Bannon is right when he says that the press is weak for that reason, because it sort of flopped in public in a very obvious way by misreading what was going to happen in the election. But that's only part of it. The other part of it is, the day after the election, I was on a panel with a reporter who had covered the campaign. Obviously, we thought it was going to be a different panel, and it turned out to be. But this person who had been on the campaign trail for a year said she spent the entire first part of the day crying, not because of who won, but because of the sense that, as she put it, nothing we did mattered. Nothing we did mattered. All of the reporting we did to show people who this candidate was, to warn them about his ill-preparedness for the presidency, didn't make a difference. And that sense that you are being tuned out is a devastating blow, along with miscalling the election, along with evidence that you are disconnected from the country. Those things are very difficult to accept. But you would think, after a debacle like that, that people who suffered from it would get together and say, we've got to do something. We have to change the way we approach this. We need to restructure ourselves. We need to start over. We need Young Turks, or we need fresh blood, or we need like a different perspective or something like that. But instead, and this is not necessarily the fault of journalists, it's just the nature of this business, they just go on to the next thing, because the day after the election, there's this huge story to report, which is, how is this inexperienced person going to actually rise to the demands of the presidency? That's a big story. And now, once he, after the inauguration, there is an even bigger story, which is, now he's in power, what's he going to do? And so, since the news never stops, there's no time to reflect on this disaster, but it was a disaster. That's a problem. Journalists are still relying on an outdated model of political coverage in which they seek their connection to the public not directly by listening to the public, but instead by going through professionals in politics whose job it is to win campaigns and to have a good strategy and to read the polls and to handle candidates. You know the kind of people I'm talking about? Like when CNN says, and now, Democratic strategist, Crystal Ball, what a name. That's actually MSNBC. Okay, but when somebody is introduced as a Democratic strategist, have you ever asked yourself, what the hell is that? Like, who is that? Why am I hearing from a strategist? And my friend Todd Gitlin said that this kind of coverage of looking at politics through the people who are professionals in manipulating us or winning campaigns tries to make us, as he put it, cognoscenti of our own bamboozlement. So have you ever been listening to like CNN or Roundtable on Meet the Press or something, and the host says like, how is this going to play with white working class voters? You know the kind of question I mean? How is this going to play? And that kind of question invites us to look at the voters the way a professional manipulator of the voters looks at them, right? So in that kind of invitation, we are psychologically being placed on the side of or in the workspace of people whose job it is to manipulate or bamboozle us. How many of you remember reading Max Weber's great essay, Politics is a Vocation? In that essay, see, somebody raised their hand. In that essay, Max Weber distinguishes between people who live for politics and people who live off it. People who live for politics want to get something done. They're activists. They want clean water. They want global warming recognized. They want rights. They want redistribution of income. They want freedom. That's people who live for politics are involved in it. People who live off politics are professionals. It's their business. It's their industry. They make a living no matter who wins. That's living off of it. So journalists a long time ago, this happened way before this election, they took a wrong turn and they began to look at us, the electorate, through the eyes of the people who live off politics. That was a mistake. And they paid for it hugely in 2016. But that's what I mean. They didn't say, man, we got to junk that model and start over after this debacle. They just kept using it. And even today, you can say, you can tune in to your favorite political talk show and see Democratic strategist as if they knew anything about what was going to happen in 2016. Okay, so that's a problem. Money, talent, investment, prestige, opportunity in journalism are concentrated in expensive cities on the coasts, especially New York and Washington. And it's pretty obvious why that would be a problem in our current environment. The career path in journalism, if you really want to make it your life's work, is basically to start as a reporter in smaller places and continuously move to bigger markets. And when that's the career path, because it's actually hard to make a living as a reporter in small markets. Am I wrong? Basically, if you want to own a home in a small town where you start your career, you have to become an editor, because we don't pay people as reporters enough really to make a life in these places. And so you either become a manager or you move out and you go to big cities. And you try to jump from Urbana to St. Louis to Chicago to Washington to New York. And one of the consequences of that career path is that people who want to be journalists in New York and Washington are doing New York and Washington journalism in Wichita. You know what I mean? Because they're trying to impress people at the next level so that they can jump to the next level and get out of these places. That's a problem. So when money, talent, investment, prestige, and opportunity are concentrated on the coasts, this is only one of journalism's diversity problems. Hate speech against journalists as a class is a routine practice for our current president, as all of you probably know. And he does this because it helps him mobilize support and elude checks on his power. So you now have, when I say hate speech, what I mean is speech that tries to engender hate in a group of people because they are part of that group. That's hate speech, right? Not because of anything individual to them, but because they are part of that group. The President of the United States regularly practices hate speech against journalists. That's a big deal. And it's effective. And he does it for a lot of different reasons. I'm not sure that he even knows all the reasons that he does it. But it certainly helps him mobilize support from his base. And if he can discredit the press, then he discredits what the press finds out about him. You see how that works? Trump's authoritarian style, that's what it is, gains traction by trashing various norms of democracy. But norms of democracy are exactly what give the press its role in public life. The Constitution does mention the press, and journalists always point this out, but it doesn't say much beyond you can't make any laws restricting the press. That's what it says, right? It's negative. It says you can't do that. It doesn't say, for example, you have to answer the press's questions. It doesn't say anything about that. In fact, the First Amendment actually stands on the side of those who would not answer questions, because that's freedom of speech, right? My freedom of speech is I don't have to speak if I don't want to. That's freedom of speech, right? If there were a law that said the president has to answer questions, that would violate the First Amendment, if you think about it. So the norms that give the press a role in our system are almost all informal norms. They're not laws. They're not regulations. They're traditions. And if we have a tradition-busting president who doesn't care about democratic norms, then that erodes the place of the press. Now, let me tell you why this could be very important. There's been a lot of leaks. You know that, right? Trump is very mad about all of these leaks. You know that. He either is going to soon, or he is now, trying to use the resources of the federal government to investigate who is leaking. Almost certainly it's going on now. He's trying to find out who's leaking. If you're trying to find out who's leaking, and the only thing that you know at the start is the journalist who received the link, then one of the things you're doing is you're digging into that journalist's communications. Right. Now, we have had a tradition in this country where if you work in the Justice Department, if you work in the FBI, if you work in the intelligence community, and you run across the path of a journalist, you don't go there because it's an informal norm of American democracy that you don't want to interfere too much in a free press because we need a free press. Those are Justice Department guidelines. You don't go there if you don't have to. Those guidelines have been eroding a little bit. They were eroded a little bit under Obama. But they're not laws. They're traditions. It's a tradition that you don't do that. He doesn't care about that tradition. That's dangerous. That's a problem. You know what? It's hard to have a fact-based debate when the leader of the free world observes no distinction between true and false and cannot himself be fact-checked. Now, what I mean by he can't be fact-checked is not that you can't do a fact check. Obviously, you can. And you can say, there is no basis for this, Mr. President. But he can't be fact checked in the sense that nothing checks him. Nothing stops him. I don't know how to express this to you. So I just have to say it in a way that's not, it's not going to really like make much of a difference to you. But it's the only way I know how to say it. He doesn't care whether what he's saying is true. He doesn't care. Now, all presidents have shaded the truth, lied on occasion, found political uses for deceit, made things simpler than they were, propagandized us. That's normal political conduct. But it's not normal to have a president who doesn't care whether what he said is true. That's different. And so the whole purpose of journalism in a free society is to contribute to a fact-based debate. But how can there be a fact-based debate when the person at the top doesn't care if what he's saying is true? How? These are the kinds of things that obsess me. You can see why I have an unquiet life these days. Right? He doesn't care whether what he's saying is true. The press conference that he had with journalists where he berated them for most of the time, one of the journalists said, you know, actually you had your facts wrong about your Electoral College victory. And he had the numbers there. He'd looked them up on his phone. And he said, Mr. President, your numbers were completely wrong. You know, and he read the numbers out to Trump. And Trump said, oh, well, I don't know. Somebody gave me that information. I don't know. I saw that around somewhere. Right? And he just went on. And like he literally acted out in public his indifference to fact. That's very strange. So it's hard to have a fact-based debate in an environment like that. Here's one where I think people in our business, the academic world, professors, students of history, students of political science, have failed. We don't really understand this. For reasons we do not understand, reality itself seems to have become a weaker constraint in the political sphere of Western democracies. It's not just in the United States. It's happening in Europe too. For example, the debate over Brexit in the UK in many ways was conducted on fantasy facts. And people didn't care in a way that what they were voting on was sort of like made up. And the day after the vote, you know, this dollar figure that they were supposed to save by leaving the European Union evaporated. Like actually, they said it's 800 million pounds and it's really gonna be more like 200 million pounds. And nobody cared because it's like nobody took it seriously at all. And the whole idea that there was a reality there was kind of like weak. So we don't understand this. We don't know why this is happening. I don't know why it's happening. But it's happening in more than one place at once. And it's related to the weakening of democracy itself in more than one place at once. So when reality seems to become a weaker constraint, then journalists which are trying to enforce that constraint by saying, well, the reality is, the fact check is, actually, Mr. President, you know, the facts are, that's what journalists do. If that is weaker, then they are weaker. I started paying attention to politics when I was 17 and the Watergate hearings were on. And that was a very fortunate thing for me. I was a lucky person because when it started to become clear that there was a really serious scandal that could involve the White House arising, it's hard to imagine, but at that time, both Republicans and Democrats had the same attitude towards this, which was, we have to find out what's going on here. It's amazing. I remember the day that Alexander Butterfield testified in the Watergate hearings that there was a taping system in the White House. Nobody knew this. There are tapes of everything that Nixon said. And he revealed this to a Senate committee that was investigating the Watergate scandal. And as soon as everyone learned that there were tapes, everybody, Democrat and Republican, had the same reaction. Well, let's get the tapes. We have to get the tapes. And it wasn't this partisan thing where the parties are constantly warring with each other. Everybody was on the same page. So today we're in a different world. And if we had Watergate-style journalism, instead of alerting the political system, hey, there's something serious here. We need to investigate. We need to find what's going on. We need to get to the bottom of this because this affects our democracy, which is the attitude then, instead what would happen is that same journalism would be received into an atmosphere in which it is shouted down, the people who reported it are discredited, culture war erupts around those findings, and probably one side would start accusing the other of the very thing that was uncovered by the investigation. And so even if we had a Woodward and Bernstein right now, the environment into which their work emerges would discredit it and push it out of the frame. That's a problem. this is something a lot of you know about, the power to inform people, meaning the relationship between you and the source of information is shifting to the tech industry's platforms like Facebook, especially, and Google, Apple News, and others. And these companies, they don't see themselves as the fourth estate. They don't see themselves as what they call content companies. They don't do that. That's not their purpose. They don't want to do that. They don't want the responsibility of being an editor, of being a judge of what the public should know. They want to flee from that. They want to be known as common carriers, as pass-throughs, platforms. And any time you try to get them to act as if they're responsible for the quality of information that they're passing on, they reject that. Because the billion-dollar future is in being a platform, not in being a quote-unquote content company. So that's them, but the problem is they are taking charge of the relationship between the person seeking information and the agency providing the information. They are now controlling that relationship. That's a problem. In this weakened state, the press is vulnerable. Billionaires can buy it in order to tame it or use the court system to bankrupt it. And I referred to two examples here. Sheldon Adelson, billionaire, Republican financier, bought his hometown newspaper in Las Vegas because he's a big player in Nevada, and he basically uses it to advance his agenda, which includes, for example, building a big stadium and attracting an NFL team because that'll help his casino business. So Adelson now has the local newspaper to do his bidding, and he has systematically dismantled the newsroom that was there and replaced it with people who are compliant. Peter Thiel, another billionaire who made his money in the tech industry in Silicon Valley, as you may know, used libel and privacy claims in the court system to essentially drive Gawker.com out of business. Gawker.com no longer exists because a billionaire decided he would sue it out of existence, and he won. He did it. So in an atmosphere like that, powerful people with lots of money know they can intimidate the press. The American press as an institution is, this is a phrase I use for it, it's like a herd of independent minds. That's not my phrase. Harold Rosenberg made that. A herd of independent minds. It has the worst of both worlds. It's like everyone's, you're laughing because you know it's true. Yeah, so everyone in the press thinks I'm a maverick, you know? I'm an individual. We're doing it our way. We have our own style. We have our own thing. And then when you watch them, they all do the same thing. So that's a herd of independent minds. So a herd of independent minds is very difficult to redirect because everybody's like ready to dissent at the earliest opportunity, even though they're conformist. So it's weird, right? So it's hard for an institution like that to shift course. It's hard for it to fight back against the designs of power. So simple example of how this works. First week of the Trump administration, they decide to have a briefing with senior officials, probably like Steve Bannon and Reince Priebus, for the press, but you can't use our names. Right, so we're going to tell you what we're doing. We're going to tell you what's going on. But you have to say, instead of Steve Bannon said, you have to say, senior officials said. What the hell is that? Why are people with power demanding to be like masked men to give out information to the press? Keeping someone's identity a secret is supposed to be for whistleblowers, people who are taking risks because power might censor them if they use their names. It's not for powerful people to escape responsibility for what they said. So why is the press attending these off-the-record briefings? Because it's weak institution with timid leadership. That's why. So that's why that matters. You see how that happens? That's a problem. Maybe some of you have experienced this. With Trump in power, there's a surplus of eventfulness. He keeps everyone in a constant state of alarm. You know what I mean by that? Like, what's going to happen next? That kind of thing. Some people even report they're having trouble sleeping. Can you imagine that? In a way, it's too much news. Too much news. And there builds behind that temptation to just shut it off, push it away. And then you can see how that could be a problem for journalists. Of course, journalists aren't giving us a lot of help either. There's no way I can go to CNN.com or WashingtonPost.com and find an easy to grasp feature that tells me what's super important and what's ephemeral. It's just one thing after another. It's just a stream of news, some of which is super important, some of which will be forgotten in 10 hours, right? And it's all kind of like rushed together. And it's up to us to figure out what's key and what's not. That's a poor quality service. Within journalism, there's this weird culture within the newsroom, I don't know how to describe it, in which you're not supposed to get too upset about anything, you're not supposed to think anything's too complicated, you're not supposed to talk about reform, you're not supposed to draw attention to your own problems. So this idea that, look, we just have to do the job is almost unanimous sentiment in newsrooms about how to respond to everything that I've talked about. Just do the job. Just shut up and do the job. Journalists are vulnerable to this kind of simplistic sentiment. And when Marty Baron, who's the editor of the Washington Post, very able journalist, very experienced leader, said, look, we just have to do the job. Everybody in journalism said, yes, because it hurts your head to think about all these things I just listed for you, right? It's just, it's easier to just go on to the next thing. So that is a problem. And all of this is happening at once. So that's what I mean by winter is coming. That's a lot, because these things are interconnected. It's not like they're happening sequentially. They're all happening at once, and they are interconnected. So, for example, the erosion of the business model leads to poor quality service, as I said, which leads to lower trust. And when people trust the press less, they're more vulnerable to attack, and the attacks are more successful with the core group of people who are open to that. And as the attacks become more successful, they become a political strategy. And the political strategy appeals to Trump because he doesn't know how to talk to the whole country. And increasingly, he's just talking to that base. And now you can see how the alternative press, with its wacky conclusions and headlines, is starting to influence Trump with its conspiracy theories, which then get broadcast to the entire country. And right there in that little sequence that I just narrated for you, about 8 of my items are involved in that. So they're all interrelated. So that's a mess. That's difficult. This is like the darkest time for a free press in the United States since World War I, when we had massive censorship and massive government propaganda. And I tried to illuminate some of the reasons why. Now, before we wrap up, there are some bright spots. I know you're going to ask me that. There's some bright spots. One of them, the most important one, is that the American people, at least some American people, are waking up to just how much they need the press. And they are concerned, more so than they've ever been since I've been teaching journalism for 31 years, about whether journalists will be able to do their job. And they are responding to this crisis with donations to news organizations that are nonprofit, with subscriptions to the New York Times and the Washington Post, with increased viewership of the news, with increased readership online. And they are, in a sense, embracing and journalists because they, for first time, it appears, realize that without them, we are really screwed. Right? That's important. And that's a good sign. Another good sign is that partly because of that support and partly because of the incredible rush of news there is to report, journalists are feeling a renewed sense of mission. They're tired. They're frightened in some ways. They're amazed by these attacks. They're stunned, but they're also deeply engaged in their work, and they have a sense of mission and drive that has motivated them to do a lot of good journalism. So that's good. There's a lot of great stories. There's a lot to report, so that's good. And people are paying attention. So all of that is working. But what about that one third that I told you about? None of that is reaching them. And we don't have a plan. Journalists don't have a plan for how to do that. And so even if our intrepid reporters find out what is going on within the Trump government and publish it, doesn't mean it's going to make any difference because of everything that I listed. Okay, so that's my presentation. Yes.
Grab my water.
Yeah, can you grab your water?
The wireless is up there.
You want me to turn it off?
No, that's for later when you guys want the wireless, right?
Oh, no, yes. So just leave it here.
Or have somebody take it to whoever wants it.
A bra can do it. Where did a bra go? Oh, she's right there. Oh, you can't because you're timing. All right, we'll figure it out. Because you can't, because you need to watch the broadcast. Okay. It's nice to meet you in person, by the way. I followed you virtually for a long time, so it seems like everyone's in transition. So I'm going to explain how this is going to work while people are kind of transitioning in and out. Hi, everyone. I'm Niala Boodhoo. I host the talk show The 21st, which is a production of Illinois Public Media here on the north end of campus. We're a new show. This is helpful for you, too, to know, Jay. We're very close to celebrating our one-year anniversary in May, and we syndicate throughout the state. So we are right now on 4 public radio stations throughout the state of Illinois, and our goal is to be a daily talk show for outside of the major media market that is Chicago. So to be for the rest of the state of Illinois. Although, of course, we include lots of news of Chicago and all of that in the show. And I had a reverse path, actually, because I started in Miami and London and Washington and then moved here. So that's kind of an interesting thing about my career path. So how this is going to work for you, all of you guys, we are recording this. That's why there's all of this equipment here. This is going to be this is going to be broadcast on Friday on air on the 21st. And hopefully that bell's not going to keep going off because the public radio producer in me is going to hate that sound in there. And Jason's going to die too, who's over there. So everything that we are doing, as Jay said, this is on the record. This is going to be on the radio. So when we get to the question portion, if you can just say your first name when you ask a question, that would be great. You don't have to say your last name. People who call into the show or tweet, they just use their first name. That's fine. We're going to apply those same standards here. So when we get to that question portion, if you can do that, that would be great. And if you can wait, obviously, also for the microphone, that's going to be another important thing, too. And Abrar, maybe I will have you do that. Abrar, who's a graduate student at the university and is one of our production staff on the show, is here to help out as well. So we're going to talk, Jay and I are going to talk for about 15 minutes or so, I'm hoping, and then open it up to questions for you all. And I have a couple quibbles with what you have said, of course, as most journalists would. So, and I'm going to say quibble because I'm in public media instead of fight. But I wanted to just start by asking you about this whole winter is coming in journalism and the idea of the informal norms that we have in our society that give the press, that sort of give the press freedom to operate, and ask you where you're seeing those norms break down the most right now?
Well, it's important to say they still exist. It's not like they're gone completely. And that letter from Mexican journalists was touching, but it's important to add that we don't have mass shootings of journalists in this country. We don't have journalists being dragged off to jail for reporting the truth. There's no prior restraint. Prior restraint is when the government prevents you from publishing your story or going on the radio and telling the truth. We don't have that yet. And so on all of those ways, the press is still free to do what it does. And it's important to say that because the situation could be a lot worse. So the erosion of norms that I'm talking about are, and this is what's so startling, is it's starting from the top. It's Sean Spicer's first briefing, which he used to berate the press, tell it, the assembled reporters, how terrible they were, and project a lie.
Did that take you by surprise?
Yeah, a little bit.
Was it the tone or just the fact that he came out of the gate with that?
The fact that this was the first communication, that it was so blatant, that it was about something easily disproved, like not even a close call.
A number. Mm-hmm.
And that he did it and then walked off. That was the most shocking thing. He wouldn't even engage in a dialogue about it, which is the whole purpose of the briefing room in the first place. And so that, just the fact that you could do that, that you would do that, that you would violate professionalism and practice right out of the gate, you know, in an unprecedented display of denialism, was shocking. So it's that, it's diluting the briefing room with all kinds of news sites that probably don't belong there, although some of them do. It's the refusal to answer simple questions. And it's the breakdown of the whole system of White House communications. For example, this week on ABC This Week with Martha Raddatz, the deputy press secretary, who happens to be Mike Huckabee's daughter, Sarah Huckabee, deputy press secretary of the White House, goes on TV to answer questions, and Martha Raddatz asks her, well, what sort of proof does the president have that Barack Obama tapped his phone? And she says, I can't speak for the president. Let the radio audience know I just slapped my forehead.
And the look of despair you had on your face.
Yeah, because,
I'll just add that.
Because what possible purpose could there be to talking with Sarah Huckabee if she doesn't represent and can't speak to what the president is thinking? So the whole idea of a spokesperson, the whole idea of a White House communications office has, for the purposes of that statement by Trump, evaporated. Because when reporters called and said, well, what is the president talking about and what is this based on? The White House communications office said, nothing. Right. And so when the White House is treating the statements of the president as inexplicable, you definitely have the erosion of some norms.
You also said something in your talk. You know, you said that President Trump doesn't care whether or not what he says is true.
Yeah.
And you use the example of the news conference where the reporter actually read to him the Electoral College, because I'm not going to say the numbers correctly, but he said, this is how many votes I got. And the reporter actually had his phone and said, actually, no, this is how many Barack Obama got. And then this is how many. In that moment when he sort of dismisses everything and he says, well, someone gave me the incorrect information. How do you think journalists should be? Well, I'm going to start with, I wanted two questions, right? How do you think audiences should handle that? But let me start with first, how do you think journalists should handle that?
Well, I think something like that has to alert them that this is different. This is a different phenomena than what they are used to reporting on. And if it is a different phenomena, then it may call for different routines and different assumptions. So I'm not saying here's how to cover that. I don't necessarily know that. I'm just saying that that is so far out of the norm that it raises a question of novelty. Are we dealing with something that's historically novel? And I would say that at least in the information sphere, in this area that you asked about, which is he doesn't care whether what he says is true, that's a radical rupture with past practice. And there's a reason for it. I wrote about this recently in my blog. In fact, the most recent piece of my blog is about this. Since the Cold War, since Americans and everybody in the world knew that the United States president could blow up the world and had the power to do that, the White House has been very concerned to show that the president is a very careful person. The president is informed. The president is in contact with the network at all times. The president is never alone. The president has the best intelligence in the world. The president has people letting him know what's going on in every corner of the world. And there's practical reasons for that, but there's also a psychological reason for that. When you can blow up the world, you're supposed to be like kind of in control of things. You know, that's a good idea. Trump doesn't participate in that at all. He has a different idea, which is sort of like, if you can blow up the world, it's great if nobody can rely on you, if you're unpredictable, if you might be a little crazy, because then they'll be afraid of you. You know, maybe that's the idea. I don't know. But
I was going to say, is that what you think it is?
I don't think he's thought it out, you know? But if there is a counter strategy to this normal strategy, it has something to do with that. It's like, and I think it might be what he has in mind, because he's known for saying that about himself in business. You know,
right, they, I like to keep nobody
yeah,
knows
I like
where
to
I'm
keep them
from.
Guessing, mm-hmm. right? That's why I'm such a great negotiator, because nobody knows what I'm going to pull out of my hat, right? But with nuclear weapons, you know, that's a different story. But the point I'm trying to make is that there's a reason why we have norms. They're not just the cake of custom, you know? There's a reason we have those norms. And Trump doesn't seem to care about that.
I want to talk about something else you mentioned that is related to this, which is this whole, you use this term verification in reverse.
Yes.
Can you explain that a little bit? Which is, this is a method that you describe that President Trump actually launched his political career on.
Right. So when I said in my talk tonight that somehow reality had become a weaker force in politics, I was partly referring to this. So verification is something journalists are very concerned with. That's sort of their bread and butter. Verification is, did that really happen? Verification is taking something that might be true or something that somebody said and nailing it down with facts, with evidence, getting the data, getting the records, getting interviews, finding out, were you there? What actually happened, right? That's like 90%
yeah,
of what journalists
do sure.
is verification. And that's why we need them, right? Because they are, in a sense, the specialists in verification. Verification in reverse is taking something that's already been nailed down and introducing doubt about it. And when you introduce doubt about it, a lot of energy is released by that. Controversy, furor, denial, news coverage. And then you can try and power a political movement with that energy. So this has become more common. And Trump launched his political career behind an act of verification in reverse, which was birtherism. He took a fact that had been as nailed down as you can get. There's the document. You can't actually get more verified than that. Where's the birth certificate? Right here. As far as verification goes, that's the end of the road. He took this fact, introduced doubt about it. That releases a lot of energy. You try to harness the energy for your candidacy. And that was the launch of Donald Trump, verification in reverse.
So I want to ask you a little bit about the news media, how we do our job, how I do my job. You can ask me questions too, obviously. I forgot to say that. You're free to ask me any questions you want to ask.
I have a couple.
I figured you did.
Yeah.
I want to ask about the fact that, you know, when you're talking about, and I agree with you, by the way, about political reporting and sort of the horse race and how that happens, but I want to ask you about that whole strategy of political reporting. How much of that is something that really happens more on coasts? Or do you think that's sort of diffused through all of journalism now, that everyone just, you do think so?
Yeah, I think for the most part, and there might be exceptions in individual markets, but for the most part, the people who are drawn into political reporting in Iowa, you know, are trying to do Washington Post journalism in Iowa. And not all, but for the most part, there's a very good reason, which is they would love to be hired by the Washington Post, which one of them last year was.
Mm-hmm.
One of their, the lead political reporter for the Des Moines Register is now a Washington Post reporter. So, yeah, for the most part, insider journalism that focuses on the maneuverings of the political class and that takes this sort of savvy tone towards everything is the style. Now, I'm sure there are local institutions, you know, reporters who've become sort of fixtures in their community, who are dedicated to that community, who probably do it different, because you find those people. But anybody who's on the career path, who wants to like be ambitious, they're going to do Washington Post journalism in Wichita, like I said, for a very rational reason. They don't necessarily think that's what they're doing, but that's what they're doing.
And then when you mentioned sort of the whole idea of strategists and the round table and the, you know, how does this play with this voter kind of thing, I'm curious about that because I feel like that happens now in a cable news cycle. I feel like that, and I actually question the relevance of cable news at this point in American society. And I'm curious your thoughts on that because I wonder how many people are actually watching that. And I think it's a generational thing. Certainly, you know, I would think my parents are an example of they have cable news on all day.
Yeah.
And I think there is a certain sector of American society that does that. And they do, there's maybe, you know, I think they watch two or three different channels. But do you think that, I just wonder about the relevance of that in society anymore, and if you see that waning. Because I wonder how much this election was sort of, in a way, the nail in the coffin for cable news networks. Or we'll look back on this as sort of...
I see what you mean. Now, CNN did make $1 billion in 2016. So it's funny when people say, no one watches CNN. Well, they made $1 billion, so somebody must have been watching them. But yes, in a way, the inadequacy of the cable news view of the world was shown very clearly by the events of 2016. But I don't think you can say it's just a cable news thing for this reason. When you watch Meet the Press, Face the Nation, which are produced by CBS and NBC, it's the same style. If you watch the PBS NewsHour, which is public,
mm-hmm.
It's not fundamentally different. Judy Woodruff went from CNN to the NewsHour seamlessly. She didn't have to change her style to accommodate the fact that she was now in public television. She just did the same kind of journalism that she did for CNN, but maybe she had more time or she could be a little bit quieter, in fomenting conflict or something like that. So I don't think it's confined to cable news. But
no, maybe I should put television news, network news in there.
But I think you're right that kind of news doesn't speak to whole sectors of the population. And you can't necessarily base your ideas about what journalism is from watching too much cable news. There's definitely a danger in doing that. But I want to ask you something.
Sure.
In your show 21, which you say is aimed at the markets outside Chicago, are you consciously trying to craft with your program a sort of anti-cosmopolitan attitude?
Well, that's interesting. I'm not sure what that means. What does anti-cosmopolitan attitude mean?
Well, you have a reason for not wanting to appeal to the Chicago market, right? You have a reason why you're defining yourself as for the rest of the state.
Yeah, I just, frankly, so, it's need.
Okay.
But aren't
there different premises to the kind of coverage you want to do? Different ideas
Absolutely.
Threaded in there? So what are they?
So I think part of it is, first of all, we're public media, right? Mm-hmm. So we have a different, I think we, and as someone who has worked in wire services, newspapers, and then made a conscious shift into public media, I think there is a mission-based element to that of serving different communities, right? So I think for us at the station, we really are about, and we're sort of expanding this both with my show and a collaboration that's going to be launching in a couple months of a newsroom, an Illinois newsroom that's also basing reporters at different stations throughout the state. I'm going to give you a long answer to this. The first is that we recognize that most public radio stations, with the exception of WBEZ in Chicago, have limited resources throughout this state. And so they have a limited amount of reporters, they have a limited amount of editors. And so WILL's sort of idea is that we should all be pooling our resources, working better together. Mm-hmm. And so it just sort of, that's kind of the first philosophy, mm-hmm. the first rung of that, right? It's just a practical level of, we think we can be doing a better job if we're all working together, which already kind of exists, you know, that. And certainly, and I don't want to leave WBEZ out of that, BEZ also works with other stations throughout the state. We do that. We share stories. Our listeners may not even realize when they hear Tony Arnold on the air, he's a reporter of WBEZ in Chicago, and we're just sharing those stories. So that's kind of the first element of it. I think the second part of it is, I think that there's a lot going on. Certainly, it would be dumb to say that you can't talk about what's happening in Chicago, whether it's economic or political, because it's a huge, it has a huge, it casts a huge shadow, not just around for the rest of the state, but for the Midwest. But I also think that there are a lot of things that are happening outside of Chicago that do not get as much notice. And I think the only way the state is going to do a better job, frankly, of solving its problems is if more people are aware of what's going on in different parts of the state. Mm-hmm. And I would say that's kind of, if that's, I don't know if that's anti-cosmopolitan, that's sort of the underpinning of the show. That's our philosophical.
Do you have any overcoming the red-blue divide aspirations?
Yeah, I mean, I think we already have that. You know, I think that our challenge is just, again, sort of the bubble of public media, right? Because we have a bubble of people who listen and love to public media and love that. And I think it's a much more diverse demographic than people realize. I think that, and I can tell that by the people who are engaging with us, it's a much more diverse politically, people across the spectrum listening. But so that's sort of where I kind of put my hope, is that the people who are interested in engaging, and I, by engaging, I mean intellectually and civically, are going to be drawn to public media. So that's sort of, I think we're already doing that. And I can tell by how many people are angry, because I get lots of angry liberal and conservative calls and emails, which I think are great, because public media, I love the passion that people have about public radio. So I always am happy when I get those, although not in the moment, but after I am. So yeah, I think that's part of it, because I think we've thought about that, which is another quibble I had with you about the not necessarily a season of hard reflection or serious
reform.
Yeah,
I knew you were going to say that one.
Yeah. Well, especially in public media, though. If you know people, public media is really good at self-flagellation. So we like to sort of think about the ways that we've done things wrong. Mm-hmm. And I will say that I feel like, I can only speak to our newsroom, we are having a lot of deep conversations about the way we do things, about being a little more transparent about what we think our values are and communicating that to our audience, about working with other public media stations across the country to collaborate so we can share more, particularly along the coasts. So that's one thing that we're going to be doing, particularly in the coming months, because I think we realize that we didn't do a good job.
Okay, so I was too harsh.
No, I mean, maybe not for everybody. I'm just talking for public media. Okay. So I can only speak for public media. I'm not going to speak for everybody.
We should let these people participate.
Yeah. So let me get the mic.
Who can help us with the mic?
Hi, I'm Dan, and I just wanted to follow up on that last exchange you had. What form, Jay, you especially, what form do you think reflection might take, whether in public media or other media, given the reality that there's always new news, right? I mean, so you know, it sounded like this existential, horrible problem that we can never break away from the way you presented it, but surely there are some practices and routines that can be cultivated that would make for some improved reflection right now. And I just wondered if you would both speak to that a little bit.
Mm. Well, what I think has to happen is, and I was talking about this with a journalism faculty member earlier, underneath the routines of political journalism, there are assumptions and pictures of the world that support those routines. So you ask, what kind of reflection is required? It's asking, are those premises still valid? So the premise of inviting Kellyanne Conway on your program is that she represents the views of the president. If she doesn't, that practice has just evaporated. The logic of it has evaporated. And so the reflection that I'm talking about is that. It's like, which of our routines is based on a premise or an argument or an assumption that is no longer valid? And if we can identify that, then we can ask ourselves, what is a valid assumption these days? And start building new routines on top of that. So that, to most people in newsrooms, you know, that sounds like that's a very academic idea. You know, that's the way they would see it. To me, it's not an academic idea at all. When Sarah Bartlett says, actually, you'll have to ask the president, I don't know what he thinks about that. The whole reason for inviting her on the air just disappeared. That's practical. There's nothing theoretical about it, right? So it's that. It's like, and my belief is that if journalists did do that, and they did it in a serious way, what they would come up with would be so much better than anything I could suggest to them. So that's what I want to see. And it's not that they weren't engaged in self-reflection after the election. They were. They did. I mean, people were very shocked by this result. And everywhere in newsrooms, there were discussions and angst. But it hasn't led to wholesale changes in practice. So, for example, look at the White House Correspondents Association, which is the professional organization of people who report on the White House, right? If you look at their behavior, the behavior of that organization, what they have wanted to do is keep everything safe. We still have the briefing, right? It's still going to be on camera, right? We're still going to have access, right? That's what they want. Now, it's possible that they have access to people who are systematically disinforming them. That's a problem. But if all you're focused on is access, you're not going to even think about that problem. So there's a desire to keep everything the same, because if everything is kind of sort of the same, then we can continue to do what we've done in the past, and we know how to do our job. And all I'm saying is there's got to be a period where all of a sudden you admit you don't know how to do your job, because a lot of the premises underneath it have collapsed. That's what I'd like to see.
I think just briefly, it's very different what I do, because I'm not in that Washington circle, which I'm frankly thankful for right now. I think that for us, we think a lot about, are we putting the right voices on the air? Are we putting voices on the air that are going to be reflective of, and this is something we've always done, but I mean, I think we're thinking a lot more about voices of people that we feel like are not being really reflected. And I think we're also being really careful about the fact that we don't put those voices on together, because I don't think it's helpful. So I don't think it's helpful to have two people who are never going to agree on at the same time. I think it's frankly a waste of time for everybody listening. So if you notice, that's a very deliberate thing we do on the program. I never really have people, not if it's going to be something where I know there's not going to be an end result that's going to be helpful. So that's a little thing that we do a little bit differently in terms of, we've always done that, so that's not a new thing. One thing that I think we've thought a lot about, and what we're going to be doing this summer, is doing listening sessions around the state about what people think American values are. and see if there's a way through that to have a conversation and do that again in pockets of community where people are not going to probably disagree with each other in that neighborhood or that community. But we can bring that on the show to other people who may not get that. So that's one little thing that we're doing, if that's helpful.
Hi, my name is Anne. And not to beat a dead horse here, but I'm thinking we can segue into another topic through this same discussion. As somebody who's no longer a practitioner of news, more an observer, what I noticed kind of moving from the standard practice into the self-reflection and the change before and after the election is before the election, there was this real dedication to exploring both sides, whether there's both sides or not. And I think there's been a lot of criticism post-election that we were so determined to be fair and unbiased in representing Donald Trump that we actually failed to show a lot of his flaws. And it strikes me that there was some self-reflection, and since the election, there's a lot more intent by the media to challenge the lack of factuality. I can't remember ever seeing a White House correspondent stand up and say, "Mr. President, here's my phone, you're wrong." And we're doing that. And I'm wondering if that's leading then, almost feeding into Trump's intent of discrediting the media, because we no longer look unbiased as a media in America. Instead, it looks like it's very biased and in trying to target these inaccuracies, it seems like an attempt to really go after him.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're saying that you think that because people are attempting to point out facts, that seems biased now.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I think you make an excellent point that, and this is one way in which what I said about reflection and reform is wrong, that they're because of the volume of Trump's misstatements and lies and the regularity of it, as well as another fact that the Washington Post fact checker pointed out, which is that there have always been presidents who said things that were untrue, but when they were fact-checked, they changed their behavior. That was the normal pattern. They changed their behavior. They stopped saying that, or they changed it so that it wasn't as blatant, or they rounded it in a way that made it, you know, more true. So they responded to the fact that they had been fact-checked. And what's unique about Trump is that he doesn't, as I said, he doesn't care. He just keeps saying it. I hope our technology is right. So. And because of that extraordinary event that happened in September at Trump's hotel, where he brought the press together under the cover of announcing something and then ended up saying that he was the one who ended birtherism, if you remember that event, which was kind of like a bridge too far for a lot of journalists. They became super disgusted with him and with themselves for participating in that. That kind of broke the cycle a little bit. And then after that, yeah, they became more aggressive in saying a lie is a lie. They were more willing to stand up and say, "I'm sorry, Mr. President, you're just totally wrong." They got rid of their squeamishness about that. But you're also right that in a way feeds into the atmosphere of culture war, of us against them, of you're our political opponent. And so there's no good answer to that. That's like a really hard problem, because he's offending journalists by saying things that are blatantly untrue. He's offending their basic values, and he's calling them to one of their basic functions, which, as I said, is verification. So it's not like they can ignore that. But by doing that, he also inflames the situation, and inflaming the situation is good for him. So that's hard.
Well, and I have a follow-up to that, to her point. Would you mention that this is sort of maybe more in the realm of academia in terms of what happens when no one really cares about reality anymore? Because that's kind of a little where we're at.
Yeah. What I said is I feel as a member of the academic world, like we haven't figured that out. We're supposed to like understand these things. Maybe Scott, I don't know why.
Scott Alhouse is shaking his head no.
I don't know why this is happening. And this is the sort of thing that academics are supposed to be able to explain to us, and we can. So
you don't have any theories about why this is happening?
Well, I have theories, but they're not very good.
Okay.
You know?
Right.
So.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Leon.
Hi,
I was
Leon.
Wondering in the context of not only that winter is coming, winter is here.
Yes.
Has arrived. When you saw the Washington Post break the story about Jeff Sessions meeting twice with the Soviet ambassador and the Russian ambassador, excuse me, and now that has generated more coverage and more news stories, and then that sort of thing on the impact and its impact on Congress, both houses, how do you interpret that in the context of the talk you just gave?
Yeah, actually, I wrote a piece about that. It had a lurid title. The title was Steve Bannon's Styrofoam Balls. But here, I know you're shaking your head. It is kind of a wacky title. But here's what I meant. One thing you have to understand about these operators who tell their followers, their listeners, not to trust what's in the mainstream media and to reject what's reported there. It's very important to understand that most of them, 90% of them, don't follow that advice themselves in the sense that they start their day by reading the New York Times. I guarantee you. They watch CNN. They may even listen to NPR on the way to the office. And they do try and unspin it. In their minds, it's biased, and they will try to adjust for that. But they don't open up the Washington Post and say, everything in here is a lie. It's the opposite. They use it as their baseline reality. But to their audiences, to their, I almost want to say victims, right? They say, don't believe a word of it. Okay. One person you could read about who kind of like reflected on this is Charlie Sykes, who's a former talk show host, right-wing talk show host in Wisconsin, who kind of like lost religion and came to reflect on this and actually admitted, like, our audiences now believe all kinds of stuff that's totally false, and there's no way for us to correct them. So if you actually derive your sense of a baseline reality from the news media, then when the news media reports that the National Security Advisor talked to the Russian ambassador, you believe it. If they were serious about their overriding the mainstream media and we make our own reality noises, they would have just denied those reports. They would have made the Washington Post produce the evidence that they talked to any of these people. They would have forced the sources to come forward, and they just would have told their listeners and the American public, that's actually completely false. That's a made up, that's fake news, fake sources. There are no such sources. Instead, they shrunk back from that at the critical moment. They couldn't go through with it. They couldn't go through with the denial of reality that they had primed us for, because actually they open the New York Times and the Washington Post every morning and they believe what's in it, but they just lie to their followers about it. Well, Congress is nervous about this whole Russian thing, mostly because it doesn't want to investigate it. But the more that comes out, the more it has to investigate it. And so that story only made Congress more nervous. They don't want to deal with this, but eventually they're going to have to deal with this. What I think is happening, this is putting on my political analyst hat, which I don't usually do, is Trump and his forces only care about the 30% of the people that I talked about that are their core supporters, because they can force a primary challenge to Republican congressmen. And if they threaten that, that'll keep the Republican congressman in line. So that's, for as far as I can tell, that's their only political strategy they have, is to keep a hold of that base
which is strong enough to represent a primary challenge to Republican congressman. And everybody else they don't care about. That's another thing, another premise that's going on. Journalists assume that once in office, presidents will try to appeal to the entire country and build their favorability ratings. That's like an obvious thing that every president does. Actually, Trump isn't even trying to do that. He's not behaving like a president who would do that.
But you don't think his address to Congress was an attempt to modify his tone for the general population?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. I think his address to Congress was an attempt to show his handlers, see, I can do it.
His handlers.
Yeah.
Not the
his
country.
His aides. Yeah. Like, see, I can read the words. If you give them to me, I'll read them.
There's someone all the way back. Oh, you go ahead.
Hi, my name's Steffi, and I have so many questions because, as you pointed out in your presentation, there are so many complex problems happening at once, but I'll try and stick to one. So you touched on how the tech industry is kind of taking over the relationship between people seeking information and the people providing it.
Right.
Do you think that there's a way that we as journalists and members of the media community can work with the tech industry? I mean, right now, in a lot of ways, they seem very unwilling when, like, Mark Zuckerberg saying, oh, no, we're not, you know, a news organization. But we do see some efforts, like trying to work with Snopes more and things like that. Do you think those are a step in the right direction?
Yeah. And both Google and Facebook, not Apple News so far, are slowly starting to recognize that they have some responsibility here, Google more so than Facebook. But there's several things that are in the way. One is, this is a contest between the very strong and the very weak. You have to keep that in mind. It's not like these are equals talking. News is a speck in Facebook's universe. It's a tiny part. And if news went away tomorrow, Facebook would still be a highly profitable and powerful company. And they're setting the terms. You know, the New York Times is actually a small business. It's a big cultural player, but it's a small business in the scale of things. So it's sort of like, trying to get Goliath to listen to you. However, there is one way in which journalists have leverage, and that is that for Google, definitely, for Facebook a little bit, if the information that people call up when they go to Google, when they go to Facebook, becomes known as more likely to be false than true, or as likely to be false as true, that's actually a problem for Google. It's a problem. They don't want their search results to be efficient in delivering you crap information about the Holocaust. That's not good, right? And Facebook is starting to realize that if people go to Facebook for news and a healthy portion of what the news is false, that's a problem for them. What they're not willing to do is begin to undertake that editing judgment role themselves. That's why when Facebook said, okay, we hear you about fake news, we're going to start putting little warning stickers on truly false stories and let you know that this has been fact-checked, which is good practice. They themselves did not want to take any responsibility for fact-checking. So what they did was they contracted with third-party fact-checkers like factcheck.org and PolitiFact, and they're using the judgments made by other people to put these little stickers on things, right? Which is okay, but it shows you how freaked they are about taking on any editorial role. Finally, one more thing on this. When they set this system up using like 6 or 7 major fact checkers, they talked to me about it beforehand as they did with other journalists, just to sort of get a sense of what people's reactions are gonna be. You know, so they kind of like gave me a preview of it. And when they gave me the preview, I said, okay, this, you know, this seems reasonable. I think it's a good step. But I just want you to know that within an hour of you announcing this, the right wing is going to denounce it because it's going to say that every fact-checking agency that you selected to help you is liberal. I just want you to understand that that's going to happen. They go, well, they think, well, we're neutral, you know, we don't think that's going to be a problem. You know, we don't have any agenda here. I said, it doesn't matter whether you have an agenda. I'm just telling you what's going to happen. And then they said, well, if that happens, you know, we'll look for fact checkers that come more from the conservative side of things. I said, great. Let me know if you find one. Okay, so this was before they announced it. The day they announced it, it didn't take an hour. It took 20 minutes. Within 20 minutes, every fact-checking agency that Facebook contracted with was denounced as the liberal media, not fact-checking at all. And this, and so, you know, because that's culture war, right? Culture war doesn't care what's true. They care about an opportunity to extend the war to another battlefield. So we're making some progress. Here's the thing that might tell it. Facebook ultimately needs social legitimacy. Because if it's not seen as a trustworthy platform and as a honorable player, then two things could happen that would cramp its style. One is regulation, government regulation, and the other is people won't trust it, so they won't give it their life, right? Like their photos and their birthdays and their weddings. And so that fact is where journalism can enter and say, hey, you can't ignore this because it could affect your whole future.
I will just add one thing to that. And I say this all the time, so I feel like I have a platform to say this, and I feel like I need to remind everyone of this. Facebook is a business. It's based on the information they give you. And everyone forgets that. And everyone turns everything over to Facebook and thinks it's free and doesn't realize the price that they pay when they do that. So I agree with Jay about Facebook is learning that it needs to be better, even simply from an advertising perspective, right? Because if you go into your advertising preferences, you can go in and you can see what Facebook thinks about you. It can tell you what it thinks your political views are. It tells you what you think your ethnicity is. And it had all of mine wrong. So I thought it was really interesting when I went in and I looked at my settings that based on the news that I guess where I was clicking and what I was consuming, Facebook was wrong. So my only hope is that because they're a business, they'll figure that out. But everyone needs to realize that they're not content creators. They refuse the title of a media company and they are there to make money. And I think that's something that everyone forgets.
And they have no editorial culture.
Exactly.
It's an engineering culture. Very different thing.
Right. And and that engineering culture means they think that they can just invent more technology to solve the problem.
Everything can be solved.
Right.
What interests me about the question, because on this campus especially, there's a
lot of engineers, yeah.
And so, you know, I frequently think of ways that we can try and work together to, you know, create solutions. But
yeah, I mean, there were two U of I students that created a plug-in that automatically, they did this in like half an hour. They did it at a hack night at MIT where they created a plug-in to tell whether or not it was fake news on your Facebook feed. Yeah, I mean, I think there are great things that you can do with technology, but there's another question.
I'm David. Professor, thanks for being here. Appreciate you coming to talk to us. And you mentioned in response to the last question that eventually Trump or the White House is going to have to deal with this question of Russia or reckon with it. Why do you think that is the case? I mean, what, based on everything that you talked about, you know, what makes you confident that he'll ever have to answer for that?
I said Congress, not Trump. Congress will eventually have to deal with it just because the weight of the evidence, the power of democratic norms, which are still in effect, the work of the committees, the relationship that the committees have with the intelligence community, which is very important for them, to them. I think Congress is much more susceptible to the pressure of accumulating fact than Trump is. Trump and the White House will try and will succeed for months now, for maybe for years, in just saying there's nothing there and stonewalling and attacking those who uncover new evidence and escalating their tactics. I mean, they're prepared to do almost anything to keep this story from expanding. So I don't have any faith that they're going to be forced to reckon with it, but Congress might.
Hi, my name's Kaya, and I have a question kind of about bright spots, I guess. I'm an educator, and I'm wondering in any of this if there's any hope for fostering more critical consumption of these, you know, texts, and how we can, and you know, encourage everybody, and do journalists have a role in that too, about educating their audiences?
Well, when the news matters to people, then it's really easy for them to get them to read it critically. So when I taught writing, which I did, I taught freshman writing when I was a graduate student, I would just like, I dumped all the curriculum that people gave me, and I would just try to find anything that students really gave a shit about a lot, and then give them writing literature articles about it. So when people care, you can get them to look at how are reports about this thing that you care about being constructed, and you know, and who's an authority and who's considered an expert and what's the storyline and what are the repeat storylines. And people who have obsessions, people who have passions they can't drop, they are ripe for media literacy because they're very sensitive to differences in tone and placement and emphasis and so forth. So that could be good. An atmosphere of emergency is good for education, you know? When people are upset about what might happen, that's when they need information. So, and also there's a very deep, intimate connection between participation and information. And when people are participating in something, whether it's street protests or sports or a music scene, that's when they know they need information. So there's a profound connection between journalism and participation, you know? So anything where people are drawn in as participants as opposed to just watching the news or being a spectator is another opportunity for education. But I'm afraid I don't have great ideas for you on that.
I would say just anecdotally, for us on the show, we have very much noticed in the past couple of months an uptick in audience and interest and engagement. We've seen that at the station in terms of donations, of people being more engaged and wanting to give money to public radio stations, especially as people have heard conversations about sort of the ongoing conversation about CP, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and whether or not it will be funded. And I've been surprised how much in the past, even just month, we've heard from our audience just how much they appreciate the show. So for us, that's always gratifying, because normally people just, you know, the rule is normally you just hear people complaining about something. So, and a lot of times it's just a tweet or something like that, but we've seen a lot of that. If that's helpful.
I think we have time for one last question. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Alex. Thank you very much for your talk. Along that, the lines of that last comment, as an educator who has worked also in journalism, I often find, you know, we're encouraging our students to interpret things differently, things that for a very long time they might have taken as fact or something as a longstanding truth. So I wonder if there might, your thoughts on, is there a need to maybe be to hedge a bit, to be a little bit, maybe a little bit more hesitant in using that kind of language of this is a fact, this is an effect, and that it becomes so polemical. For instance, if I'm trying to reach out to those that 30% that would automatically discount maybe what I'm saying as an expert, there's, you know, obviously it's not about the facts, it's about something maybe more deep-seated of a kind of resentment of, you know, of elitism. I'm just wondering if that kind of just debate on language, as far as, is it about trying to find that bridge, not using the language of fact, this is a fact, this is not a fact, but maybe rather talking more in terms of building a kind of sense of community of, oh, well, this is, I like the word evidence that you used. I'm just wondering if it gets so loaded when you use that word, I think.
Yeah. I think it's a good point. I mean, there is something about fact and fact check and you have your facts wrong that is a little, not a little, can be a lot inflammatory, and it puts people in a defensive posture. So I think there's something to that. Evidence is a little bit more neutral. Also, I'm a big fan of using this construction in journalism. Here's what we know and what we don't know. Right? And what we don't know, or we don't know yet, can be a very powerful thing. Finally, let me tell you a little story from like 20 years ago in my career. Way before the culture war was as bad as it is now, Foundation President David Matthews told me this story that he was in a meeting in Kentucky that was about gay marriage, which at the time was a very explosive issue. And it was an auditorium full of people who were deeply divided on the subject of gay marriage, with a lot of LGBT people who, for whom this was like a foundational issue of identity and equal rights, and another group of people who were, for whom it was equally foundational, like in their ideas of marriage. And the minister who was running the meeting could see it sort of spiraling out of control. I'm sure you've been in conversations like that. And he says, wait a minute, hold on a second. Show of hands. How many people think this question of gay marriage is a profoundly moral issue? Everybody raises their hand, right? And he says, let's start there, right? So even though it doesn't erase any differences, right, finding that moment where you can get everybody to raise their hand, maybe we should start with that instead of the facts that everybody is arguing about. You see what I mean? Like there's something in that idea of let's start with what we can all agree on. Now it used to be, we thought we start with a common world of facts and then we disagree on what to do about them, right? That was then. Now like we don't have the luxury of that anymore. Daniel Patrick Moynihan, you're entitled to your own opinion, you're not entitled to your own facts. Well, sorry, but that was 1980, right? In 2016, people feel very entitled to their own facts. So maybe we have to start in a different place. So I'm with you on that.
I would say I think it's also, I love that in 2016, people feel entitled to their own facts. I think for us, it's also, this is going to be a very public radio answer, but I think that stories are really important because I think it's just about sharing individual stories, because I do think ultimately, I do very much believe in people sharing their own voice and just being able to connect with someone on a human level, which is, I know based on lots of conversations I've had with Scott about political communication and how people can come together, that interaction is one of the few things that actually helps change people, is person-to-person interaction. And so I think that as much as we could do that, that's also a very helpful thing, as much as journalists can facilitate that. And we think about the power of individual stories or images and making people realize, hey, actually, maybe we do have something in common, is kind of helpful too. But that's kind of a, maybe, I don't know, is that too typical of a journalism answer for 2017?
Well, no, I don't think so. I mean, it is a very interesting part of this phenomena that when you bring the people who are so divided together in the same room and they talk to each other as human beings, which does happen sometimes artificially, sometimes just in the course of community life, the divisions at the national level don't really appear as much. So that's interesting. There's got to be a reason why in person it doesn't have the same force that it does in the voting booth or on cable television or in public debate. So I think there's something there. This interesting little news startup in Seattle that I'm following called Evergrey, because it's not green in Seattle, it's always gray.
It's fine.
They did this little experiment that I promoted in my Twitter feed. They took 10 of their subscribers from Seattle, or 20 of their subscribers from Seattle, and they actually took a road tour to the nearest county to Seattle where 75% of the people voted for Trump, because 75% of the people in Seattle voted for Clinton. So they went to this rural county in northwestern Oregon and arranged with like a local community group just to have 20 people from Seattle, 20 people from this town meet and talk to each other in like one-on-one and two-on-two settings. Now, I think the value of that for journalism is not that 20 people means we've overcome our divides, because that's a small number of people. But if you listen to what happens in a conversation like that, it helps you frame the news so that it's not polarizing. That's the value of it, mm-hmm. is you can reframe the subjects that come up based on the human interchange between people. So maybe we need more of that. Maybe we need more of the beat that Dave Weigel at the Washington Post has. He covers, I think this is an interesting beat, he covers the extreme left and the extreme right. Don't you think that's a cool beat?
He's also really funny.
Yeah, and he's so funny. And
that's the good part.
Yeah, he has a sense of humor about it. He's also, he knows the players, and he knows enough about these movements that they kind of respect him because he knows kind of like the obscure details that they know, right? So I cover the extreme left and the extreme right is kind of divide bridging, right? So maybe we need more of that.
That's a good place to end, I think, and it's 7 o'clock. So thank you so much. Thanks for being here, Jay. Thanks for being here.